Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining this live event, lesson 70 from the Java Fundamentals stream, and we are going to discuss and hopefully finish the chapter about JDBC today, and we'll cover the transactions, which was also one of your questions from the last time. Thank you very much for joining. If you have questions, don't forget that you have a live chat there, so you can ask the questions in the live chat directly. And of course, you can anytime follow me on Twitter and LinkedIn as well. And if you didn't watch the event live, you can leave the questions in the comment section below, and I will try to answer them, of course, as soon as possible. With that being said, let me show you what I've prepared for you today. I will share my screen, and you will see my workbench first here, and an empty project I have just created just to already have it. It's a simple Maven project. You know, in the last lessons we've used Maven because we need to add the JDBC driver dependency, and it is the easiest way to do it without a lot of complications. And that's why I'm going to use also today Maven. Of course, I'm still continuing to use the latest Java version, which is Java 15 at the moment. And we are going today to implement a very small app and discuss about transactions. That's my plan. Transactions and in understanding and knowing how to use transaction is not necessarily part of the OCP exam. From what I recall, I didn't see up to now questions in the OCP exam, or at least in my case, I didn't find questions about transactions, explicitly about transactions, but they are a really important subject and, from my point of view, part of the fundamentals. So that's why I'm going to discuss them in this stream, this Java Fundamentals stream. You first need to have an idea about how transactions work at the JDBC level. That's what we're going to discuss today. And then you will understand them as well, very well, when you will use an application framework such as Spring. And if you'll watch also my Spring stream on this channel, you will find out that I have discussed also transactions in the Spring stream, but there I have discussed them with Spring as an application framework. So now what you will see today is basically what's behind an application framework. When you, for example, if you might have used up to now transactional in Spring or in another kind of transaction management in another application framework, what you see there, it's basically it has behind what we discussed today. And again, in my perspective, any developer should know also what's behind an application framework, and that's really useful when you have a more difficult problem and you need to debug a little bit further to know what's deep down in your framework, and not only know how to use some annotations and so on, what many developers tend to think that's enough today. Okay, with that being said, let me create a short table, small table that we'll use. And in my demonstration today, I will consider that we have accounts. The accounts have an amount, each account has an amount, and I want to implement a simple, straightforward functionality where you transfer a sum from an account to another account. That's what I'm going to implement today. And we'll discuss, based on this example, why are transactions important and which are, at least from the top of the mountain, the most important characteristics of transactions. We call them ACID. If you've ever heard about, maybe read something about transactions, you might have learned about the acronym ACID, which stands for atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability. And that's what we're also going to touch today, but within this example. So I don't want to create a very complex application, because otherwise you won't be able to focus on the important subject we discussed. That's why I only create, say, account is the bank account representation, but I will make it very simple. I'll just say it has an ID and an amount, and let's make double this amount. Because it will be at least a number representing money, representing the money in that account, and apply it and create it in the end. So this is my account here, and where I will add for our demonstrations a couple of records. One of them say account one, and it has 1,000 whatever that is, euros, USDs, whatever you want, and 2,000 here. Cool. And I will apply to have these records in my table. Now, let's go into our application. Again, just a simple empty Maven project for the moment. You have already seen that in my previous lessons. So I'm just going to directly add the dependencies I need here. And you know that I'm just using plain JDBC with the JDK, but that's where I need to add my JDBC driver, because the JDK comes only with the abstractions and I need to give it the implementation for specifically the technology I use, which is MySQL in my case. And that's why I need to add, in this case, I need to add the dependency for the JDBC driver for MySQL, which you find it in the MySQL group ID. It's called MySQL connector Java, the artifact ID. And I just took the latest version I found because it's irrelevant at this point. And remember, I always do Maven reload project just to be sure that my ID brings all the dependencies from the repository. Sometimes it happens that it doesn't download my external libraries, and I have to do that manually. So I create a reflex in just updating my Maven project every time I add a new dependency. But that should be enough. So now we know that in the class path we have the needed dependencies, we have the JDK 15, and we have the JDBC driver. So the next thing I'd like to do is directly create now the main package, where I will have the main class. And now you'll have to be a little bit attentive, because one of the things I'm going to do today is just work this application. As close as possible to how a normal standard class design should look like. So I'm going a little bit beyond the normal example. I just want to think about this application also from the point of view of its class design, the packages, the way we should use the classes and so on. So up to now we created a lot of small examples, but from now on, we are already experienced enough to think also about some other things, like in case of creating a use case in our application, where should we put that use case and so on and so forth. So besides discussing about transactions and the way they work, you will find some other things valuable in this lesson as well. So take everything that I say as being important, because what I planned for today's lesson is actually a little bit more than maybe you expect. So I have the main class, and it's a very simple application. What I want to do to prove the transactions is just implement the use case where I take an amount from one account and put it into another account. So that's what we consider to be the most straightforward way to represent a transfer of money from one account to another. And let's see what problems could we face when we do something like this. In the previous lessons, we have already discussed about how to create records in the database, update them, select them. So I rely on all those things. Hopefully you have already seen the previous lessons, because I'm going to directly use those things and I'm not going to explain them in detail anymore. And now one thing in regards to JDBC and in regards to data persistence in general is that when you have data persistence, you create those classes, those objects that work directly for the persistence responsibility in, we name them, these objects we name repositories. So that's why now I'm going to create a package named repositories. And my class is the class that will be working with the accounts. I will name it account repository. So I'm just going to right click, create a new class, account repository. My account repository class is where I will add all the relevant methods in my case of my application to work with the records in the account table in my database, the one that you have just seen. And then another thing is that the use cases, so that business logic of your application, that's usually implemented in classes that are called services. So I'm going to create another package that I will name services. And this is where I will create a class. I will name, say, money transfer service. And this is the service where I will implement my use case, the one I've stated at the beginning of our lesson, transferring some amount from an account to another. So that's where we implement our use case. Then afterwards, we will certainly need to get connections from the database. And in the previous examples where I did just shortly explain you how to create a connection in order to add a record in a database or update or delete or select, I just created them in a try catch directly there, where I also created the logic for working with the persistence layer. But now I'd like to separate the connection in a different class, and say I will create a package DB manager for this, because it's a manager and it's related to the database. I will actually call it DB connection manager, and this actually is a class that's taking the responsibility of what you will in a real world example replace with a data source. Now, I don't want to go into data sources now, because I will go too much beyond the scope of this lesson, and it would even say that I'm going too much beyond the fundamentals. So let us still rely on getting the connection with the driver manager. But what I want to say is that at some point, you will still have an object that's managing the connections in your database, and that's what we call a data source in real world examples terminology. A data source is an object that's managing the connections to a database, and usually in real world scenarios we use data sources that are pooled. That means that they borrow connections and they manage the connections such that your application doesn't need every time to communicate over the network and spend a lot of IO time with the database. In my case, again, I'm still relying on the driver manager, just to make the example simpler. Is it better to call packages with plural nouns or with singular? Well, I'm not quite sure. Very good observation. Probably you're asking, why did I call it manager here and repositories and services here? I'm usually calling them with plural. But I can't say it's necessarily a rule, and I'm calling them with plural just because usually in a real world example, I in a real world production ready application, say I have more than one class here, I will have multiple repositories, I will have multiple services and so on and so forth. But I guess it's the same thing if you want to call them with a singular. I could call it a developer taste. If you want to call it singular or plural from this point of view. My DB connection manager, actually, again, I'm just simulating here a data source, but I will be using the driver manager to get the connection from the database. So that should look something like connection, get connection, and I'm just returning here the connection that I will create, the same way you already know from the previous lesson. So I'm using the URL, the URL, the username and the password. I'm placing them directly here, but in a production ready application, remember, these are parameters, they should never stay in the code directly. especially the credentials. The credentials should never be direct in the source code, should not even be in a properties file. Credentials are sensitive, and in a real world scenario, you would store them probably in a secrets vault or something similar, depending on the way you deploy your application. But for the moment, we only focus on something else. So I would like to take this chance to still put them here, even though I, as I explained, don't do that in real world examples. So JDBC, MySQL in my case, because that's what I'm using, localhost, and Java is the name of the database, and then again username, and locally I'm using root for my example, which is just the default super user that I get without any configuration when I'm installing SAMP. And I return driver manager, get connection for this URL, username and password. And the get connection, as usual, is throwing a SQL exception. You know that SQL exception is a checked exception, so we need to treat it or throw it away. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to actually try catch it, and instead of just printing it here, I will throw another exception, a custom exception that is a runtime exception. Remember, one important thing I'm not deeply discussing now the subject, but always use custom exceptions. That's one of the rules in real world examples when you have a specific situation, because that's what an exception represents. An exception in Java, as we have discussed also in one of the earliest lessons of this stream, it represents a specific situation in the execution of your app. And never just use throw exception or throw runtime exception. Sometimes in examples you see that. In real world scenarios, always create a custom example with a proper message representing your exception. So that's what I'm going to do now. I say exceptions. Exceptions in which I'm just creating DB connection failed exception, which is representing my exception. I make it a runtime exception, and usually you do also again specify a custom message, that a proper custom message, but allow me skip that to make our example simpler. And I say throw new DB connection failed exception. So now I precisely know when I'm calling this method, if I get a DB connection failed exception in my stack trace, that I faced a problem with connecting to a database in order to obtain a connection. So precisely what I'm trying to do here. Another thing is that in order to make my access simpler to this method, I'd like to actually take the opportunity of creating this class as a singleton. I know that we might haven't discussed the singleton pattern yet, and I know that I have in mind, because many of you asked to create a separate stream about design patterns, at least the most relevant design patterns and the ones that you still use in apps today, because many of design patterns, well, they are not necessarily used in application nowadays because time changed and the way we implement apps changed as well. But I will take the opportunity to create a singleton now, and I promise to explain singleton as well as other patterns in a future stream that I will create. In case you don't understand this, no worry, just trust what I say. This class will everywhere share the same instance, will have only one instance, and that instance will be the same that will be shared to all other classes. And to implement something like this, the most efficient way in Java is probably to simply create a static private class inside. You say private static, sometimes developers also use a final, private static final class, they call it singleton holder, and inside we just declare an instance of the class. We want to make a singleton, which is the outer class in our case. And now the only thing you need to do is basically create a public static get instance method that returns the instance in the singleton holder. And that's a very common solution for implementing a singleton with Java. And now basically wherever you want an instance of this class, of course one more thing should be, in order to be a real singleton, we would probably want to make the constructor private so that no one from outside can actually create instances. And now in order to actually take an instance from outside, you can't call the constructor anyway because it's private, but you can anytime call the static method getInstance, which will return you this singleton here inside this inner class. And because it's inside this static inner class, the class loader will basically create this instance when the class is loaded. So first time you access the DB connection manager, that's when the static members of the class are initialized, and the class loader will also create will initialize this inner class here and will create this instance. And this is also a concurrent way, a synchronized way to write your singleton, because the singleton holder actually takes care of the synchronization. So it's a nice thing, because even though you see nowhere, you see that I didn't use anywhere synchronized or any blocking object as we've discussed in one of our previous lessons, this is still a singleton that's synchronized, and you can use it through multiple threads at the same time, because the class loader will take care of the synchronization, even though I didn't do anything special in my code for that. And now that I have the DB connection manager and I have a way to obtain my connection, what I'm going to do is think about what I actually need to make a transfer from one account to another. So to transfer money from one account to another, I need to be able to get the details of an account so that I see the amount of the account. And then I can transfer by updating the value with basically subtracting the value from the first account, the one I transfer from, and adding it into the second account. So I need to be able to select the details of an account, and I need to be able to update the details of an account. So that's what we need to implement in our account repository here. So I need a method, say it returns the details of an account. And that's where I would like to say something like this: account, let's say find account by its ID, and I need a class to represent that gives me the information that I need. I need a class to model the data, to model the way the account looks like in my application, and that's why these kinds of classes are actually called models. And that's where I'm going to create myself another package here called the model of my app. And inside the model of my app, I create the account class. And the account class, it's only we call it POJO, plain old Java object. Its only purpose being that describe the way in which an account looks like for my application. So in my case, what does an account have? Looking into my database, an account has an ID and an account has an amount. So private int ID, private, I'm going to declare my amount. It's actually a double in the database. I can make it a double here, but I want to also enforce this. I see this mistake more and more often, of people using double to store information with precision, where they actually need very good precision of the decimal point. And if you use double for that, like for prices or for, in my case, the sum, the amount of money in the account, you might find out that Java, because of the way it stores the double and float values in the memory, during some operations, which can be addition, subtraction, multiplication, or division, any of these, you might find out that you miss decimals during a specific operation. That's not an issue, it's a known way in which double works in Java. So if you don't care about the decimals, it's fine to use double. If you care that much of a 001 or 0001, which usually happens in case of money, then you use a big decimal for that. So you don't use double. And that's why now I would prefer to use big decimal as well, just to enforce this thing and make sure that those watching this video will not do this mistake of using double, even though it actually looks easier to use double. It's a primitive in Java. We have also wrapper class over it. It's not the type you'd like to use for the sensitive to precision float numbers. And fortunately, I have created my account object very light, and I only have these two attributes. So it's enough for me just to create the getters and the setters, which I usually like to generate with my IntelliJ. And in a real world scenario, I most of the time like to use Lombok, which is a project, a very nice project that helps you in minimizing the code by writing the getter, setters, constructors, sometime even more than that out of the box, and you only have to add some annotations for that. But I will tell you more about Lombok in a future video. Let's now just use the getters and setters the way we generate them from IntelliJ. And of course, having an account here, I can now import the class. And guess what I need to do? I need to write a SQL to find an account in the database. So select everything from account, where ID is question mark, that's my attribute. And then what I'm going to do? Well, for some reason, I will later explain in this video, I will prefer for the account repository to also take the connection as a parameter here. So allow me not taking the connection here inside this try catch, but taking it as a parameter, and later I will explain you why I do that. It's related to the today's subject, transactions. So that's why I'm doing it like this. I receive the connection in the repository instead of taking it from my DB connection manager. And now you know from the previous lesson that I can use the connection to get a prepare statement. Statement con prepare statement for my SQL. The prepare statement will be closed at the end. Of course, it throws the SQL exception, which I have to treat with a catch block here. So I'm treating my exception. Let's make it fast and only print stack trace it. And then we have the statement. We need to set the parameter. Set int in my case for the first question mark the value of the ID. So we replace the wildcard for our parameter with the real value, and then we say, do we expect to have, of course we only expect to have one account because the ID is the primary key. So I can directly write something like this: statement execute query and we get the result set. This is the result set. And then say result set next. So if there is a value, if there is an account with this specific ID, then I will create the account and return it. What do we do otherwise? That's the question. So we have two options for the else here. We can either throw an exception. We can consider that's not possible not to have it, or we can simply make this an optional and allow our method to take values for IDs that don't exist, but in that case, return an empty optional. And another question, what do you mean by saying that when using operations on double, we can lose decimals? Are there approximations? Yes, the way in which the operations work in the memory make that when you do a subtraction, addition, division, or multiplication, you might find out something like this. You have 12.20 plus, another 12.21, and then you get the result, which is 24.40. And then you'll of course, or 0.4 directly. And you'll of course observe here that it should have been 41 because it's a 24 plus 21 and you only get 40. I don't say that precisely for these numbers it works like that, because it's not any number you take and it will simply look like this. But you will find situations in which something like this might happen. I just invented them now, so this pair of numbers might not be the case in which you lose the decimals. But there are pairs of numbers for which for addition, multiplication, division, or even subtraction, you have a situation like this. So that's why you should never use double for values that are sensitive to decimals, because you might actually lose decimals when this kind of operation happens in Java with doubles. So with doubles, you might find this kind of case. If you want, I can search for a case, not now because it would take me time, but I can find a pair of numbers just to prove you that this happens. But you can trust me that this happens sometimes. And that's why we never use double for these kinds of values that are sensitive. Super, thank you as well. And I was saying, let's actually use optional, because it's very often that we use optional in such cases. That actually means, in case I don't get it, I will just return optional empty. And if I get it, then I already have the ID. I just want to take my amount, which is a big decimal, and say result set. Get big decimal of, what was the name of the column? It was really amount, so it's amount. And then I return an optional of amount. And that's my method. Of an account. Oh, my fault, sorry. So I need to create var account is new account. And on the account, set the ID and set the amount. And then, of course, return the account in an optional, not the amount. Okay, that's it. Perfect. So now we have the if else. Of course, it tells me here, maybe I think it's just easier to simply put it here. In case we get an exception, we also return an optional empty. Maybe I would have created here another custom exception in a case of a real world scenario, but let's simplify it again, because otherwise we complicate it too much and you won't focus on the important thing. So now I'm able to find an account, and I need to, again, going back to our discussion, we need to be able to also update an account. So say update account, and in this case, of course, again, I need to have the connection, and then I only want to be able to update the amount on the account. So I'd say big decimal amount, and then my string SQL would look something like this: update account set amount is question mark, where ID is question mark. So update the value of the amount where a specific ID, and that actually means I have to get the ID of the account as well, for which I'm changing it. Maybe seeing that this is basically an account, I can actually just get an account because it has both of them. And then I will do the same thing. I'm going to create a statement, con prepare statement of this SQL. And again, I need to treat my SQL exception, which is a checked exception. And of course, set the two parameters. So I need to set, first of all, is the amount, which is a big decimal. Say for the first question mark, account get amount. For the second, which is the ID, is account get ID. And then I just have to say statement execute update. and that will execute the query in the database. And now with these methods, let's try to implement in the money transfer service, which is our service, the use case that was called transfer money. And we transfer money from one account to another. And we assume that we get the ID of the account for which we transfer the money, say from account to account, and then big decimal, or yeah, big decimal, I guess it's enough, amount in this case. Is there any reason why you are using string for SQL instead of var? No, it's not a reason, just the way I happen to write it. So the idea is that usually var is not necessarily a word you would like to use pretty often in real world examples. It's generally, you might have, like in this case here, it might not really be correct from a clean coding point of view that I'm using var, because you see, of course, my IntelliJ is smart enough to show me what this statement is, even though I've used var, but it's not necessarily that all the IDs will do that. And the idea is that if you simply see var statement, comprepare statement without this here that's displayed by my IntelliJ, you won't see actually what type is it. And so actually here maybe it was even better if I would have used prepare statement. But I'm using var more and more often in my fundamental tutorials. That's because in the OCP exam I know that they pretty much use often now the var word in the OCP 11 exam questions, and I want people to get used to it. But usually you have to use var when it really minimizes your number of characters on a specific line. Writing string, it's 5 characters. Writing var is 3 characters. I didn't do a lot of minimization in this case, is it? So no specific reason why I was using string and no var. Now this is my transfer money. What I want to do, say I declare here a private final account repository. I will make this a dependency constructor, but let us just create the instance here to be easier, account repository. And now that's what I'm going to use here. First of all, to obtain the from account, I will just find the account. And I see that I need a connection here, so that's where I will get the connection. And I'm using again a try, and I'm getting the connection using my class that I've created at the beginning, that's called DB Connection Manager. And if you remember, DB Connection Manager is a singleton, so I can write DB Connection Manager get instance get connection. Then here is where I have to again use a catch for SQL exception, and now I can say the connection goes further, and from account is the ID of the account that I'm getting, and I'm getting now an option for this account. What if there are both transactions going on an update but second update fails? That's what I'm going to discuss now. So One second, allow me, I'm going into transactions as soon as I finish the example. First of all, let us try the example and then discuss what a transaction is. Otherwise, you might not get it right from the very beginning if I go straight forward into transactions. So a little bit of patience and I'm going into this, okay? So say here from to account, I'm getting the to account. And I have my optionals here. Now I will create another exception that I'm going to name account missing exception. And this will be again a runtime exception that I'm going to use here and say var A1 is my first account, and I'll say from or else throw what was it, account missing exception And the same for the second account, the one I'm transferring money into. So now I have the accounts. I've thrown exceptions if I don't get the accounts. And I want to transfer the amount from the first account one to the second. So I will have, from amount that will become A1. I can actually directly put it here, set amount, is it? Say A1, get amount, subtract amount. So I'm subtracting the amount from the first account, and then I'm going to say A2, set amount, A2, get amount, add amount. So, and I'm adding it to the second amount. And that's where I want you to be attentive, because now I'm not using a transaction. So this application works now precisely as you have also learned it from the previous lessons. We don't know what a transaction is still, and we are not using a transaction. But I'm starting with it by not using a transaction, such that you find out why it's relevant to use a transaction. So you will see now what can happen if we don't have a transaction. Let's do the last part of our use case, which is updating the accounts using the account repository. So I say account repository, update account A1, and account repository, update account A2. And that theoretically, and we will test it, when I call this method, which is basically my use case, it will subtract from one account the amount and will add it to the other. Observe that I didn't test if there is enough money in the account and so on and so forth. I'm just simplifying the case on what's relevant. So we will just try it. Going back into my database, I will try to take 500 from the first account and put it into the second account. So I'm saying money transfer service, new money transfer service, and I need to specify from account 1 to account 2 that I want to transfer 500, which is actually a new big decimal of 500. That's everything. And now let's see if I didn't miss anything. When running this application, we should see that the result is the transfer of 500 from one account to another. So my app says that it completed the use case, and I refresh here, and you see that 500 went from the first account to the second account. That's what we expected. But let me show you what we actually didn't expect. Is precisely the question I have received in the chat. What happens if something fails in between these two lines? Or maybe with line 30, in this case, with this last line of my use case. That's a very, very good question, because that's precisely the question we wanted to ask. In a real world scenario, you of course might have some other things in between these two, or simply the second one might fail. So what happens, say here I'm throwing a new runtime exception in between these two. And yeah, it doesn't work like that, but I can trick it into working, like saying if true, throw new runtime exception. So you see now I'm actually simulating an exception in between those two. And let's see what happens if I try to transfer again 500 from the first account to the second account. Watch carefully the numbers I have in the database before. 500 and 2500. And now I'm going to my main class again and run it. And we see the exception, that we have thrown. And we are going to the database and refresh it. And it's still 2,500 here, but the money disappeared from the first account. So we have a use case that is not working correctly. We took money from the first one, but we didn't add them into the second one. So I'm pretty sure you don't want your banking app to work like this. I'm sure you don't want to send money and find out that the money were never received. That's basically what can happen if we don't use transactions. So how our app works at the moment is that our JDBC driver creates one transaction per each operation. Because I didn't specify anything special. Now, every operation I do, like this update or this update account here, has its own transaction. And that means that this one might happen. The update will be successfully done, will be committed in the database, which means that the data will be persisted, as you see. 500 have been taken out from the first account. But then if it never gets here, then that's the way the data will stay. From our point of view, we call this inconsistency of the data. Because we were expecting to still have the same amount of money in the bank, but now we don't have the same amount of money. 500 went somewhere and we don't know where. They were simply disappeared. So that's why we need to use transactions and make sure that when we have multiple update operations, they either execute all of them multiple modifiable operations, maybe even better saying, that are part of the same use case. We have to make sure that they either execute all of them or they don't execute at all. Like in my case, if there was an exception after the first update, this one should have been, we call it rollback, that is, the data should have been reverted to the way it looked like before it. And that's one of the things a transaction does, and is basically what the transaction is mostly known for. Its first characteristic from that asset is the atomicity, which means that in a transaction, you start a transaction, and at the end, you commit the transaction. If something went wrong and not all the update or the modifiable operations from that transaction happened, then the transaction rolls back and the data reverts to the way it looked like at the beginning. And that's pretty relevant because it's exactly what we need here to be sure that we don't lose money. So in case something happened and not all the operations could have been executed, then you want to make sure that the data rolls back and the first account doesn't lose money because you weren't able to move them into the second account, so they should stay in the first one. And to do that, we go into our DB connection manager. And in JDBC, what you want to do to make sure that you use transactions is just change the default configuration of a connection before returning it here into set auto commit false. So you say set auto commit false. This actually means please don't do yourself the transactions for every operation. Let me decide when to commit or roll back a transaction. And in this case, the transaction will start with the first operation and then I have to commit it at the very end. When I decide to commit it, or if I decide to not commit it at all in some cases. And in this case, I'm going here in... I'm going here in my service and I make sure that, okay, I create the connection, that's where the transaction begins. And now at the very end, I say commit. I don't have to do anything explicitly because if the Runtime exception will be thrown here, the commit won't be reached. And because my connection is already in try with resources block, it will close automatically, which means it will roll back at the end because I didn't commit. But with this very small change, you will see a very big difference and very important difference in the way my app executes. Let me first start by commenting this out and still see that my app is working the way I'd like it to work. Let's go back with some numbers, say 1000 here, and say 1000 here as well. Oh, sorry, I should have pressed the saved. Again, 1000 here and 1000 here. Apply. And now you see that both accounts contain 1000 as an amount. And I want to transfer 500 from the first one to the second account. So what I expect is that after I run the application, the first will have 500 and the second will have 1500. And because I don't throw the exception anymore, this should basically work the same as it was working previously at the very first run in our today's lesson. So I'm running it again and make sure that it's indeed still transferring the money. And you see that the operation worked. The first account now contains 500, while the second one contains more, 500 more, which is 1500. But if I go into my app and again uncomment the exception I was forcing in between, when I'm now running the app and I just ran the app, I see the exception. But what you will observe is that no operation happened. So in the end, I still have 500 in the first and 1500 in the second. While previously, when I wasn't using a transaction, well, 500 have been taken from the first account, but they haven't been added to a second. Now it doesn't happen. Now the transaction takes care of reverting the data to the way it looked like at the beginning. So here. So even though I update the account here and this operation is successfully done, it will be reverted, it will be rolled back because of this exception and especially because it didn't reach the commit here. Using transaction is fundamental, is very relevant. Of course, most of the application frameworks take care of this and you write less code. You don't have to manage the transactions in JDBC directly as I'm doing here. But it's very good to also, as I've stated at the beginning of the lesson, very good to know what's behind the framework as well. You can start watching the Spring Framework stream I've already recorded on this channel, and you will see me at some point discussing about transactional and transactions. Well, what you see there has behind it. Is what's behind it is precisely what you've seen now here. Transactions managed, but in that case by the framework I'm using, which if I remember correctly, I've been using Hibernate in the stream. But behind Hibernate, this is what's happening. This is how the transactions are managed from the JDBC level. Besides the atomicity, remember that transactions also have other three important characteristics. And I'd like you let's do like this. Okay, much better. And I'd like you remember them. So A is from atomicity. C is from consistency. I is from isolation. And D is from durability. Oops. And consistency is related to the data remaining consistent after committing it. Isolation, you will find out if you watch the Spring Framework stream that when working with transactions, we have actually multiple isolations levels of the transaction. They are called read committed, read uncommitted, repeatable, read and serializable. And based on which one you choose, you will get into specific consequences in consistency. And durability stands that after you have persisted the data should remain persistent, should remain durable on the drive. So how many calls to the database were before the autocommit true and after the autocommit false? The calls to the database are the same, actually. So that's also a very good question. So you ask me, basically what you ask me is, when I'm doing here the update account, is this update account still communicating via IO to the database, or is it only in the application now? And the answer is, now it's still likewise before, it's still communicating with the database. So nothing changed in terms of operations. This is a relevant thing to understand because it's in terms of performance important sometimes. The only thing happens now that when the exception occurs, because I have the connection inside the try with resources, the connection will be closed at the end automatically, and that's when the transaction will be rolled back. But the operations that managed to have been sent, they have already been sent to the database management system. But they will be rolled back by the database management system because you have rolled back, you have closed the transaction without committing, and that's equivalent to rolling it back. Now, it is relevant sometimes to avoid sending the operations to a database. So that is, avoid completely sending the update. And that's basically when you have a lot of updates to be done. So say you have 1,000 records, maybe 1,000,000 records in the database, and you want to insert something for each of them or update them or something like that. And then it makes a very big difference if you take each one of these records and update them with its own IO communication to the DBMS. So in order to avoid that, what you do is using batch updates, which is also a feature in the JDBC. So if you want to avoid communicating via IO with the database for each operation, one of the things you can choose to do is batch the operations and send them all at once to the database. If you will go here in the prepare statement, say here, you will see that there are some methods that are related to batch. What's a batch is a group of queries that you collect and then you send all together to the DBMS in order to avoid too much communication over IO. And in cases where you have a lot of operations, you will of course observe a big improvement in the performance with sending one batch at once instead of repeatedly IO operations with execute update. So again, to shortly re-answer your question, it didn't change anything in my case in terms of IO. It still sends the same number of queries to the DBMS, just that it's reverting them because we roll back the transaction. But in some cases, when you'd really like to minimize the IO, because you have more, you have multiple queries and you don't want to repeatedly send one by one over the network, then you can batch them and send a batch with all of them to the DBMS in only one call. And that's where you can improve the communication over the network. But this example of mine, this doesn't improve the communication over the network the way I have programmed it here. Super. And I guess this is everything I actually wanted to show you. And I hope you liked the example. Thank you very much for the questions. And the next thing we're going to discuss is not about JDBC, at least I didn't plan to discuss about JDBC, but I plan to step into another chapter that is more complicated, but again, in my perspective, it's still part of the fundamentals, and that's related to reflection. If you, however, have more questions on the JDBC or on anything else, you've already seen that I read all the questions you have in the comments, and if you add me on Twitter or LinkedIn, we can discuss there as well, and I will try to answer them separately for you. But what we've done in this lesson and the previous three lessons on JDBC is basically, I would say anything you'd like to know for your OCP exam at least, and that should be helpful. And also a basic to know when you work with any kind of persistence framework about what's behind the framework. That's because I don't expect that much JDBC to be used today, so you might not necessarily use it in real world examples very much now directly, but it's important when you use something like JDBC template in Spring or Hibernate or JOOQ to know what's behind those as well. It really helps sometimes when debugging it. A newbie question, Eclipse or IntelliJ? That's a very good question, actually. It's not a bad question at all. I will try to answer it, but the idea is that the IDE you choose is really depending on you, and I do suggest you try all of them. During the past years, I've been working as a developer. I've used JDeveloper, I've used Eclipse, I used NetBeans, I used IntelliJ. All of them, in terms of writing, they are pretty much the same, because even though IntelliJ is very smart, especially if you take the ultimate version, which is which costs money, which is licensed. I have an ultimate, what you see here, which is licensed under my company's name. But even if it helps you write code faster, which is true, I'd like to remind you that always when you develop software, 90% of the time is spent reading code and thinking of a solution. Only 10% is actually spent writing code. And a lot of developers seem to miss that. And that why is that relevant? Is because you shouldn't expect that when you go from Eclipse, which is, say, in terms of writing code, a little bit less... it has less features, say, that help you in writing code than an IntelliJ Ultimate. You shouldn't expect that now you will become 10 times faster just because you are using IntelliJ and not Eclipse. So, as a student, I would recommend you any IDE, because it really doesn't matter and you don't have to invest money. As a developer, as a consultant, I still wouldn't recommend you pay for your IDE. But if you have a company that pays for your IDE, then of course I wouldn't mind having an IntelliJ Ultimate, because it's a little bit better than the others in terms of writing code. But again, don't expect that now you have IntelliJ Ultimate, you'll be 10 times faster, not even twice faster you'll be. Because again, in general, it's only 10% of your work to write code in production. 90% of the time is spent on reading code and on thinking on solutions, not on writing code. And that's why it's some kind of mirage that when you get a better IDE, you will be faster. You will be a little bit faster, but not necessarily a lot faster. Hope I answered your question. So that's my opinion. Thank you very much, and have a great time for learning further. Cheers.